American LCS. Now is that part of the show where we let you do the talking. Earlier in the broadcast, we asked you, what is the most impressive thing you saw in the NALCS during Super Week and why? And here's what you've been saying. At Alexia de Ferenz, Curse, coming out strong on day two. A lot of people say they had a rough schedule, but they are making the best of it and more.
Oh yeah, I would go out to say they had the roughest schedule possible, and they went 3-1. Incredible control there by Xspecial all throughout. Definitely deserving to be up there on the tweets.
Yeah, a fantastic showing by them, turning around their season. Our next tweet we have is at I Am Tunk. CLG's Link living on the edge in the game versus Cloud9. Truly playing a dangerous game.
Ah, I see what they did there. It's a mastery. Oh, that's the joke. Yeah, Link had a fantastic Twisted Fate all throughout, to the point that people are banning it against him now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, we've seen a lot of Twisted Fate across all games, too. And at Smack24123 says, has to be the real Thresh Prince Xspecial. Best Thresh play I've seen all season. GG, and good job on 1,000 assists.
Exerting that lane thresher all throughout the game.
Oh, dear God.
100 games, 1,000 assists, averaging 10 a game. Amazing job there by Xspecial. Doesn't just mean he's getting assists. It means he's not taking his AD carries kills.
Absolutely. Thanks to everyone who wrote in, but we'd love to hear more. So keep hitting us up at LOL Esports and use the hashtag LCS to join in the conversation. But now, let's get back into the games. As we throw it over to Freak and Kobe, Dignitas and Cloud9 have both had their season tripped up by complexity. It's something the teams may have in common with the overalls wearing guy named Mario.
Complexity has surprised me in a good way. They've been the real blue shell, and it's really, really fun to watch. People are like going to go on the match, vote C9, vote Dignitas, and they have like 9 or 10%, and here we are with the Complexity blue shell. Just go into the match and just beat those two teams. But the fact that they were able to beat those teams either means they did not prepare enough, or Complexity really does have the talent on their team to beat anyone and be a real blue shell.
Well, thank you for TSM. Blue Shell's only at the first place cart, and right now they're still about second place in here. They can make their way up if they win here. But
yeah, it's a bonus to not being in first.
They're impervious. It'll go around them. You just got to dodge it. They won't home in. Guys, welcome to the desk. I'm David Victorley. Helping me call these final two matches of the day is Sam, Kobe, Hartman, Kensler. And we're jumping right into the action with Team Solo Mid versus Complexity.
Yeah, TSM have been trying to really figure out what strategy works for them. Yesterday, they played slow against Dignitas and lost. But in their second game against Evil Geniuses, they played fast with an early game composition utilizing strong solo laners like Syndra, Renekton, and they also used Elise, who Amazing is currently undefeated on, 7-0. I expect that they will return to a strategy that focuses on that early game power, controlling dragons, and a comp that allows them to win without having to wait for the late game. This should be a match that favors TSM. You know, they are undefeated in games against the bottom three teams.
But like we've seen, Complexity does have the chance to beat those teams above them. They are now 2-1 against Dignitas. They're undefeated 2-0 against Cloud9. And they can just add TSM to that book of top teams they beat.
Yeah, and they had another upset already against a top team today, Dignitas. They're also a very, very happy team, always. Yep. Comical. Let's see. They showed a lot of determination in that game, you know, and it doesn't look like it wore them down at all. They were able to stay calm, and they clawed their way back from a huge deficit. That being said, they are 0-2 against TSM, and this is going to be one of Complexity's harder games. They found a lot of success with Robert Exley's Tristana, who has had a very strong laning phase and been a reliable force in that late game. And whenever you have this much success with a champion, though, you can expect your opponents will start banning it sooner or later. So I'm curious to see what the next AD Complexity will use if TSM do go ahead and ban that away. Because that's a ban that's really jumping out at me right now looking at Complexity. Yeah.
The only game that Complexity's lost this week was CLG, and they banned the Tristana in that match. It's a pretty important thing to think about. Of course, let's check out the starting lineups here. On the blue side is Team Solo Mid. Dyrus in the top lane, Amazing in the jungle, Bjergsen in mid, Wild Turtle on AD carry, and Gleeb on support.
And on the red side, it's Complexity. Up top is Westrice in the jungle, Kez, mid Frawley, AD carry Robert X Lee, and supporting Bubba Dub.
And I wonder if actually the like backup plan then for TSM might just be relying on their dual lane of Wild Turtle and Gleeb. They have stepped up, I think, a lot recently. They're playing better than they have throughout much of the season, and maybe they just hold them down instead of just taking the ban there. Robert, I think, is definitely the main guy to watch on the Complexity lineup. Maybe you can hold him down in the duo lane.
Yeah, some extra jungle pressure never hurts either. Bubba Dub was talking about how he picks Nami really early just because it's a sustained support, and even if they do get jungle pressure, they ensure that their bottom lane won't be kept down. That's why he hasn't picked things like Braum.
Well, right off the bat, Tristana gets removed away. Good lesson learned here by TSM. Like to do 2-0 on that champion throughout the week. The Lee Sin away from amazing, but the Elise is the one that I think is really scary. And it's just weird. There's so much tunnel vision on Lee Sin, right, on that champion getting removed away. And there's all these sleeper picks. Not even sleeper picks, but just like ones that don't get the same respect.
Elise is definitely not a sleeper
pick. Yeah, I mean, sorry. I didn't mean to say it that way, right? But the fact that people keep letting them get this champion.
Uh-huh.
And also, keep excelling on it.
I have to say, sometimes people get really fixated on statistics, mm-hmm. but really the first thing that they teach you in statistics, actual statistics class, is that correlation does not prove causation.
Yeah.
So just because you see a trend does not mean that that is causing the outcome of these games.
True.
Everybody got to be careful because we're throwing around a lot of stats nowadays.
Mm-hmm. Make sure you use the right ones. Kale removed away there, team still in mid. Statistically, one third of the time Kale gets banned, roughly. Kassadin, though, the early hover there, Bjergsen getting a rare Kassadin pick against Complexity. And it's going to go through.
That's what happens when you ban all junglers here. But Complexity knew what they were doing. And we'll see if their plan pays off here. They actually don't even first pick a jungler after spending three jungle bans and letting Kassadin through. So instead, they get that very strong comfort pick, Lulu. Westrise had one of his best performances of the entire year on Lulu, holding down Inox Jax, and actually coming up with one of the game-winning plays on that champion. As well as Thresh, always a very strong support champion to pick up.
Well, you know what I like about this, is Amazing's go-to after those three jungle bans is Jarvan. Thresh is great against Jarvan. Lulu is great against Jarvan. You either flay him out of his EQ combo, or you just make the guy that he goes on gigantic and tanky and probably more durable than Amazing in the first place, and then life is pain for TSM.
The thing is, Amazing has gone tank Jarvan, so Jarvan, pretty much they've been using him for utility of attack speed for flag and the Cataclysm. We'll see what he comes up with this time, though, because if you do go damage Jarvan, then your worst nightmare is going to be those flays interrupting your combo and the Lulu knocking you up once you all in, because he is a very committed champion once
yes.
you dive in.
Pretty much picks one direction and goes all the way through it, though. One thing that concerns me, though, with TSM is just the fact that I don't like their team fight right now. There's the small anti-synergy of Jarvan, Gragas. Sometimes you knock him out of the Cataclysm, and then you're really sad about it. But also just the fact that none of the champions picked have high sustained damage. And so if you knock someone down, it's like Kassadin does 400 to you, and then nothing else happens.
Be quiet, freak. They're mousing over Tryndamere and Urgot.
Oh, okay. I didn't.
Don't you realize?
Sorry, I forgot. Complexity's not trolly at all. They would never lie to us with the hover over.
The thing, though, about TSM's comp, it's not that bad, because Kassadin really thrives when you're able to create space in a team, and he's really good at chasing down champions. So Gragas as well is good at chasing down champions. They have a good team for if they're able to control the map early, the vision,
yeah.
they can actually catch a lot of people out with this combo here.
But that's the difficulty, is what do you have to run away from? When they hover Kog'Maw's, like, that's what you kind of need there. That was LMQ 2 games ago when they picked Tristana late, like, shoot, we need damage output. And Vasili on Tristana was that. TSM, like, you're right, if they get control, Kassadin and Bjergsen can do these crazy things. But if you're not forced to run away, there's no chasing.
The thing is, if you pick Kog'Maw, they already have Vi. It's
yeah.
not a lot of people like to pick Kog'Maw into Vi, because that is a guaranteed engage there. So Turtle switches. Caitlyn also has a strong late game.
Reasonable.
Her laning phase is much better, though.
Yeah.
So actually, TSM do go more early game oriented there. With the strong laning phase, Nami, Caitlyn can bully anybody they want.
That lane is freaking rough to fight against Complexity. I would not be surprised to see them go for a lane swap, even though it's uncommon, just because of how difficult it is to fight this combo. Tristana is gone. Gotta see you. I guess we already know what the dual lane is. It's the Thresh Lucian here, but now we get to see. Probably says he likes playing support mid laners. He likes the Lulus and Orianas of the world, so that could be mid Lulu, and they could go for a counter pick up there. Ryze is going to be the lock-in. The thing is, Ryze, we've seen it go both lanes, same as Lulu.
Interested to see who ends up, how they can maneuver these lanes, because Kassadin actually doesn't have too bad of a time against Ryze with the magic damage shield, especially if he can start sustain items. Very interesting. Double teleports there for Complexity.
as of right now.
Interesting. I actually do like TP Ryze a lot, though. I know we saw TP mid lane from CLG's Link yesterday and didn't work very well. They lost that game, if I recall properly. But TP Ryze I like just because his base damages are enough. You don't need Ignite to win. You itemize durability. You don't need to like run barrier or heal to like survive ganks. But showing up and being Ryze in a team fight or a random jungle gank is incredibly powerful.
Yeah, they're also showing the teleports really early here, and Kassadin can easily switch over to teleport as well to match if Bjergsen felt like they didn't want to deal with that late game pressure, because Kassadin showing up in the same place is very bad. Snowbally champion, if he gets one or two kills, gets out of control quickly.
Yeah, well, the blind pick of summoners looks like it still is Ignite, Kassadin, TP, Ryze here. Let's go ahead and check on the LOLesports.com vote to see who you've been giving the thumbs up to. 85% of the vote, TSM leads Complexity.
Keep sending in your picks to at LO Esports and use that hashtag TSMWin or COLWin. You're right. They can't see the teleports.
Nope. But it's going to be the overall, I guess, strategic mobility advantage there for Complexity. They can show up as a group of five. A little bit more easy on one side of the map. Vi and Jarvan, the two junglers as well. Great CC, get to the back line, lock someone down champions, and they can start good fighting.
Thing is, we have not seen a good Jarvan in North America. We really haven't yet. So maybe Amazing is going to show us up, because his Jarvan has been improving. It started very, very low down, though. So he's come up to a decent level. We'll see if he can actually have a very strong game on it this time around. Jarvan can be a very tricky jungler coming at you from many different angles.
Well, we'll see if the TSM jungler can live up to his name here. Graduate past mediocre on Jarvan. The online crowd and the in-person crowd still behind TSM here.
Yeah. Amazing has been improving on his Jarvan, so we'll see how far he has come. Three people deep utility going biscuits here. Not too deep, but
9 points.
Semi.
Well, probably 21 utility. It's a normal build for a Ryze.
Yeah, he probably is.
Okay. Those are easy. I'll give it to you.
I wasn't even.
Yeah, okay. Ruby Crystal Start, though, is also kind of fun. I typically see a lot of Sapphire Crystal Starts for Ryze for the extra damage output, the extra spells in lane, but not the case here for Prolly.
Dade busts that one out in OGN sometimes.
Oh!
Got him.
I mean, Prolly said he got these tattoos in Rune Prison. He's fighting an officer of Piltover in the opposite lane, so he's going to send him back. Prolly's in violation of his parole. How many kills has he gotten today? He should go back to jail.
Looks like he is going to go heal up, because he put all that money into the Ruby Crystal. Doesn't want to start out with less than maximum HP. Early shot, though, from Turtle is going to give him confidence. That's what it's all about for TSM, the early game here.
And right now we're going to have just standard lane starts one out, so...
I do like this from TSM, because a lot of the games where Complexity upset top teams have been the top teams making mistakes in that bottom lane and giving Robert really strong early leads.
Yeah.
It's going to be hard for TSM to mess up in this bottom lane and give them an early lead with Nami, Caitlyn. We'll see how they can pull it off, though. Bubba Dub, if he lands one of those perfect death sentences, you can always turn a lane around.
We'll see what happens as the junglers get through their camps. Kez, a bit of a slower start than Amazing here, both of them starting on the northwest side of the map, so they'll be deer down by the dual lanes a little bit later on. Wild Turtle holding pretty equal in this. Looks like actually a slight push lead. Oh!
Oh!
He didn't count the damage right there. It's 25 for Caster Minion.
I don't even need the money. I'll watch the minions die.
And it hurts Glebe too, though. He gets one minion per CS that Wild Turtle gets, or one gold per CS that Wild Turtle gets. He's screwing his teammates over as well.
Junglers both started on top side, though, so they are both going to end up down bottom. Glebe goes for that 3-minute ward just in case there is the double buff gank from Vi, trying to protect himself.
I do want to see how this mid lane matchup goes, though, as well. The junglers, of course, can pretty much always gank mid. Your paths always put you within about 10 seconds of that lane. Right now, the early push down from Prolly, Bjergsen does not have his slow available yet. And when you learn E, you still need to learn to get the stack. So, Prolly, no, there's no gank assistance for Bjergsen right now. Not for a while.
Bjergsen going to be able to CS pretty well under the turret, though he does miss one. Kassadin, one of the biggest buffs to him, since he does get pushed in early by many, many champions, was the change to his W, because it makes him so much easier to CS under a turret. And that's really what's been helping him out in a lot of those matchups that were just too tough for him to even take before. You can see Prawly, the biggest advantage that he gets over Bjergsen are from all these auto attacks that he threads in with his spells. So whenever he throws a Q, he will also follow it up with an auto attack for the extra damage.
Speaking of auto attacks for extra damage though, Dyrus on Gragas here actually doing a very good job in the top lane. Right now, six minions ahead of Westrice. He is running a little bit low on mana, but with Teleport, that's not that big of a problem for Gragas. And so far, so good for the TSM top lane. So the smallest of 100 gold leads so far for these guys. But hey, that's the big difficulty for teams a lot of the time against Complexity.
It is something that Dyrus focuses very heavily on, and you're often surprised by just how much CS he does have in the top lane, because he does play that safer style and concentrates completely on the last hits, rather than going for a lot of excessive trades in lane that would cost him. So it is paying off so far. Meanwhile, mid lane, we have Jarvan waiting in the bushes, helping, trying to shove this lane in so it doesn't stay in front of the turret here. Bjergsen did go with that sustained start, by the way. Crystalline Flask.
Now goes the minion wave, so Bjergsen gonna have a pretty safe recall. Probably when he does choose to go back, we'll have teleport to aid him if he wants it. Neon Strike Vi with the awesome recall sounds. The engineer who actually made those sounds posted about that a couple days ago. Talked about how he did it.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of tweaks to sword slashes and clangs.
I think the most interesting sound effect I heard the creation story of was the Zach one.
Oh yeah?
Yeah, where they filled up a condom with fluid and smacked it against the wall a couple times.
Nice.
Not what you think it would be filled with.
Wow. You know Mordekaiser's are actually all heavily distorted guitar sounds?
All of them?
Yep. Every single sound is some kind of tweaked, heavily distorted and tweaked guitar.
The way that they come up with these things.
Hey man, our engineers
creative.
Are cool. Yeah, oh yeah. They're pretty cool bros. Right now though, TSM just creating a 200 gold lead in the laning phase. Not too much going on, but the fact that Kassadin is laning just fine is a good thing. At least for TSM. Of course, keep in mind, like Ryze is another one of those great late game champions who just loves to have a fairly safe lane where they're farming without much difficulty. It is still the case here for Prawly.
Oh, heartbreaker for Dyrus. Probably the biggest event that has happened so far in this game. Cannon minion missed. Wild Turtle missed one, but it was just a regular melee.
Yeah. Robert actually just got that cannon minion with his W. That was from far away, too. That was a trick shot.
It's the little things.
Uh-huh. All right, Westrice back to the TP. Chalice opening for him. Dyrus easily has a Catalyst if he wants it.
All right, TP advantage for Dyrus for a couple seconds. Let's see if he uses his to get back to lane. Now, Lulu, a lot of teams, when they see her top, if you have a more aggressive top laner, sometimes they will go for the early dives. Not the case here. Amazing farming up. Same thing for Kez, though. Both of these junglers, fairly fearsome ganks once they hit that level 6. We'll see if they can actually gank different lanes, though. Because if they do meet up, I like Vi in the matchup. She can actually counter a lot of what Jarvan brings. Woo! Blue buff over to Bjergsen here. Level 6 as well. So this is where it does turn a little bit, this lane. Because if there is a jungle intervention mid, then Bjergsen will easily be able to follow up on any sort of gank. So, as you can see, Prawly definitely wants his blue as well.
Yeah, it's responding right about now, and there is ward coverage for TSM. However, their bot lane is already back, so they will not be in position to contest. Complexities is back themselves. They got the timer. Prawly's dancing. There you go.
Whoop there, Tyrus. Dyrus is doing some work on Westrice now, actually. Post level 6, Grog is starting to try and bully him around. Pretty much the CS lead was just due to better coordination there from Dyrus. Hand-eye coordination.
Yep.
Good zoning now with the barrels here. Of course, all Gragas maxing the Q first. If you lay it on the ground and let it sit there.
Does more damage.
Does do more damage. So it's a great zoning tool. Even for somebody like Lulu.
Were you casting the game yesterday where...
Oh, he knocked
him
into it!
Oh my gosh, Westrice. Something like that happened, actually.
Yeah.
It was a slice and dice, I think. There's a barrel waiting for Renekton. Mm. Hops over, gets blown up.
Yeah, that was Kwass.
Yeah.
Strong placement.
Yep.
The forethought. Oh, so teleport has to use to go back to lane here. They lose their early game potential of joining another lane. By the way, that is one of the reasons why this early game has been so slow. Junglers don't like to gank when there are multiple teleports up on the other lane.
Yeah.
Because either of those guys could ruin the gank. But now, since both teleports are down, Amazing makes his first move and gets nothing out of it except a little of Robert's time.
Dyrus doing a great job here against Westrice. Dyrus not going to go for any more harassment while he's under turret, but you're seeing 92 to 64. Dyrus is exceptional up here on this Gragas pick. You've yet to see it work, I want to say, extremely well so far, the Gragas in the NALCS, though he's been fairly popular. This is the first one I'm seeing actually dominate lane like players expect him to.
Dyrus, his first try at the Gragas didn't go so well because, you know, he had the full AP build, and the ratios aren't quite as good as they used to be. So now he's adapting. Gragas, as you said, definitely a very popular champion worldwide at the moment. A lot of people refer to him basically as the sort of AP Renekton, just because he is so strong in lane, but does fall off later, especially if he goes for the full tank build. Looks like he will go hybrid tank, out of Aegis here.
Another attempted trade right there, and you know, Styrus still, he focuses so heavily on getting advantage in lane, not necessarily killing his opponent, he is yet to try to all-in Westrice. He's just like, yep, this will be some free damage. Back right out, sustain up. Catalyst proc's gonna give him another 200 mana or so. Westrice, nice knock up there, looking for the way to win against Styrus, but there's the ulti, he sends him back down the lane.
The way they're playing, I would have thought a jungler was right behind him.
Yeah.
And I'm surprised they, he didn't back off from that trade there, but Westrice has pretty good ward coverage.
Bottom lane though, look at this one, 99 to 86 in minions. Babadub, a lot of bullet coverage on him.
Amazing joining so that they can create pressure and hopefully cause Robert to lose a few CS. Did not even notice the early scrying orb from Turtle.
Kez around the wings, can they get this dive to happen? Health bars are really low, I don't know if they want this. And they do not. So nice job by Amazing. Shows up to Wild Turtle's lane, pushes the turret down, and that Glebe Turtle combo picking up the Caitlyn Nami.
Yeah, that's the product of Caitlyn Nami harassing lane. So much range abuse and the ability to add damage and speed to Caitlyn.
Ooh. Nice little move there. Bjergsen is just completely treading water against Prowly right here, but now actually looking to go much more aggressive. Ignite is down. One more Ahri gets the kill here.
He's not treading water. Oh, he doesn't go for the dive. All right, he does have a lot of sustain. Whenever you have Catalyst and you have a Crystalline Flask, Bjergsen can just go trade over and over and over and just completely out-sustain Prowly at this point.
Yeah.
Very difficult for Prowly to stick in this lane. Amazing is not really going for ganks, just basically going to aid anytime somebody moves up to a turret, get some extra turret damage down. Meanwhile, Kez has been on cleanup duty after everybody gets pushed out of their lane.
Yeah,
coming
to
soak up experience. That's always a bad sign for a jungler. Absolutely. You never want to be in the position where you have to show your position in lane just to clean up minions, because the jungler is supposed to be the person for a team early game that is creating almost all of the plays and dictating what the plan is for your team. If he's on cleanup duty, and it means your team has to wait till that late game, they would be happy though, trying to scale up Ryze.
Yeah, I just wonder if it's going to be enough for them. You know, Lulu, Ryze, Vi does pretty well late as well, so maybe that is just the safe game plan for Complexity.
Though they definitely can't just rely
on
late game here and champions outscaling. We'll have to see if this dragon control really becomes an issue, because At the moment, Bjergsen and Darius both completing their Rod of Ages on a fairly quick clip here.
Yeah, it's not bad.
It means that it is going very well for TSM. We'll see if the dragon does become an issue enough to cause these teams to break the treaty and actually go for a fight.
Well, Dyrus has been brawling pretty often, but Westrice back in as well. Barrel's going to get dodged away from. Q comes out again, but Dyrus barely takes damage there. Well, you know, you talked about the pregame, though. TSM, they won last time by picking some good early lanes, pushing sort of the advantage, and then kind of getting control. TSM have an advantage in every single one of their lanes. And Amazing's just kind of backup saying, if something goes down, I'm ready for you, but feel free to out-CS and get turret pressure.
TSM's mid-game is very, very strong here. It takes 10 minutes for those rods to stack up, but only a few more left here. Should be about the 20-minute mark now. They've both got 60. At that point... Ooh, they're clearing out vision around Dragon. Maybe they do want to start it off. Teleport for Dyrus is available, but so is Westrice. The problem is, Dyrus keeps bullying Westrice out of lane, so if he leaves to go back to base and heal, then TSM will gain advantage in top lane. Thus, Westrice has decided to stay in that top lane, try and clear the minions, and hold out to see if TSM are going to go for this dragon.
But still, it's more health that Westrice keeps losing there. Dyrus' ulti back up in one quarter of the time, and maybe that's enough to push Westrice around or get a gank top lane. In fact, it's Kez who looks for that to try to salvage. Westrice is losing lane down here.
See if he can punish Dyrus. Oh, he goes through the ward here.
Looking for a good body slam. Ult goes in anyway. They want this. Dyrus now ulti for about 5 seconds. They're trying. There's the wild growth. Dyrus drinks to get some damage reduction. Q comes down very, very low, but there's the ulti up against the wall.
Westrice
misses the Q, but gets it with the E. Turret will kill him, though, and trade it back. But that is still a kill lead. TSM rush for the dragon in the meantime. And they pick that one up.
Yeah, big win for TSM. While we were all focused on the top lane and the action going there, as soon as Kez shows up top, we were just talking about this is the stage of the game where teams are going to take Dragon if your jungler shows up top. So yes, they were able to curb the aggression from Dyrus in the top lane and relieve some pressure on Westrice, but they lost the Dragon out for it anyway, and which would have been a bad trade just by itself, but Dyrus got the return kill. So it's a huge win for TSM.
One thing as well is there was a pretty bad miscommunication there. You're going to see, I believe Kez got aggro first, but didn't keep it.
Yeah, let's see. Once he does get in there, I think Kez walks away with a decent amount of HP. He wasn't sure Westrice was going to flash for this kill. That's why. Yeah.
Yeah. You could have taken one more turret shot and Westrice would have lived there.
Boop.
And now look at that one. Westrice, they know he has no flash and no ulti, so the damage comes through. That's a much more well-communicated gank. Grats TSM, 2,000 gold lead.
So Amazing, definitely with the better movements as far as junglers are concerned here.
Yep.
For the mid game. Because not only does he make the better trade getting Dragon for top lane aggression, but he even returns and gets Dyrus another kill. Two kills here for Gragas. Let's see what Dyrus can do with it this time around.
Going for some magic dust right now, knowing he's facing plenty of it on the enemy team. And this is TSM who have gotten, I want to say, better and better as the week has gone on. There are sort of adaptations to how the game's being played around them. It's going much better, and they're poised to go 3-1 on this week. They're poised to tie for first if everything else goes right.
And I have to say, the way that they're playing this game, they're just so calm. They are always so calm against these lower teams. One of the reasons why they do have such a good record against these teams, they go with strong early and mid game, and they just play it out as expected. They take the better trades, and they slowly accrue their lead. And they never slow down either.
Nope. Dyrus keeping it going, 17 minutes in. Top lane out of turret goes down as well, and these are largely just the lanes winning by themselves. We've had a little bit of interference from Amazing. He shows up to the lane to push it down, but the advantages are earned just in the heads-up battles. Down the line, TSM outplaying their opponents. Complexity have not found a way in. You were talking about Kez playing cleanup.
Oh!
He gets up the Wraith.
Small win there. Blue yeah. Wraith for Kez.
But yeah. Oh no, Prolly goes for the teleport. Can he get out before the Q lands? Yes, he can. Now Complexity, though, like struggling to get vision control back. You're seeing TSM, now the outer turrets are gone, are heavily warding up that northern jungle. The pings are still there around Dragon. Complexity haven't been there to sweep those wards away in minutes now. We have to see them do something.
Utter domination here from TSM, controlling the whole map. All perimeter defenses down for Complexity. TSM have lost zero turrets, and they're able to shove at will.
Wow. Lee walks on a 1v2, and Complexity runs away from him. That's how you know TSM are owning this map, is they see a support like, there's more people around. Westray's got to be careful, knocks up Dyrus into the air, burns his ulti, gets some decent damage down, actually. 700 health on Dyrus. Walks on out.
Well, oh, red buff here on Turtle as well.
Ulti.
He can go even deeper.
Wow, 250 health left on Kez, who does not have an armor item to his name. That's actually going to help Wild Turtle a lot. It means that two items, Wild Turtle actually crushes the front line, that which it is of Complexity.
Yeah, Ryze especially would be the person to start getting some armor here, but he actually opted for magic resistance since he's facing Kassadin, and he's already having problems with Kassadin. So no armor early on for him either. Maybe he'll work towards a Glacial Shroud next and yeah, just leave that Negatron Cloak as is.
You know what's interesting though about the way that team comps are being built nowadays? There's so many more AP tops that top laners and mid laners, even junglers, are building magic resist items first instead of armor items first. And because of all the Infinity Edge AD carries, like their two item builds are very expensive, Infinity Edge 3800. So Last Whisper comes so late in the build, yet no one has armor, they don't need it anyway.
That's why I'm actually liking Thornmail more and more nowadays, because if you're just gonna get one armor item later, because you spent more of your early time itemizing against double APs, then Thornmail is pretty much the way to go.
Yeah, AD carries also don't have lifesteal for a while, so they actually shred themselves. On top of that, they don't even run 9 MR glyphs either, so their magic resist is usually around 38. And
the Diamond
Robber forced back. Tidal Whip comes across Dyrus in that fight, and out goes the AD carry. But Complexity, not a good spot in this fight whatsoever. Out goes Kez running over to the left-hand side. TSM completely control that.
I was just shocked at them going for this dive and how much damage Dyrus did to Robert until I saw he's got a needlessly large rod in his inventory. He's not going with the classic super tank Gragas after Rod of Ages. He's so strong right now, and he had such a good early game. He's going for more AP damage.
Wow. And you saw it right there. Push Complexity clean off that tier 2 turret. Ooh. 21 minutes in, TSM not flinching at all. A patient laning phase, but a well-played one.
Yeah, they are now showing aggression still. This is a team that's not afraid to dive you if they have this type of early lead against you. Complete control of the map, though. They don't even have to go for these dives. They still are, and they're taking out the turrets afterwards. Pretty much the entire jungle is TSM's territory here. They can easily take the dragon because the ward line is all the way up at the buffs of Complexity.
You can see it over by the wolf camp above the white by the choke point and the one left-hand side by mid-tier 2 as well. All of Complexity's moves are going to be spotted out by TSM. Bjergsen grabs himself a blue buff. And away he goes. Rod of Ages plus the Seeker's Arm Guard. See if he goes for the full Zhonya's from there. Honestly, they can do almost whatever they want. Looks like that is going to be Zhonya's for Bjergsen, so he will be even harder to pin down. Complexity have only found one kill in 22 minutes here.
Yeah, just the simple lane bully strat from TSM that, as expected, against a bottom team. Not having much trouble yet.
Well, and ever since about week 4, TSM have just kind of been collecting themselves. They said, you know what, we're going to figure out how to play this game properly. Lokodoku gets a lot of credit for that one, but the players themselves have been steadily improving as well. Gleeb and Bjergsen, the guys that he wanted to have the voice on the team. Mm-hmm. And when you see a calm, collected TSM making all good choices as a group, that's Bjergsen and Gleeb right there, making the calls, telling people where to go, and it follows through nicely.
Looks like we are seeing another full tank Jarvan, by the way, too. So since they have Amazing to be front man for soaking up damage, I'm really happy with the way Dyrus is going here with that early needlessly large rod into a Zhonya's. Mm-hmm. He still is technically a tank build here, but he's got a lot of power behind it as well.
And so TSM actually managed to sneak in armor into their build. So Robert X. Lee also is going to be much less powerful as time.
Double Zhonya's completed now. Wow, yep. Bjergsen got his as well. Mm-hmm. Gonna be so difficult for Complexity to pick up any return kills at the moment. Ooh, dangerous. These jungle fights are very dangerous for Complexity because we talked about the ability of this team for TSM to chase people down.
Yeah.
If you go and try and fight these small battles around the buffs where TSM already have ward coverage, you're really opening yourselves up for those picks from the Gragas and the Kassadin that can come very quickly. And even if Turtle is in lane shoving a lane, he can add the headshot from mid lane to finish off any sort of pick that Bjergsen and Dyrus come up with.
It all just spells fear for Complexity there. They're looking to follow Curse's footsteps, go for the 3-1, start catching up in the roster. Right now, Complexity would not make playoffs with this standing. And going 2-2, plus Curse getting another win. This could not be good for Kez right there. He's about 3/4 health on him, and he can just barely click the Lantern, but Bjergsen is there. There's ulti onto 3 people, probably gets a shield, just gets away, but there's the Ignite, there's the Wild Growth, but it's not enough. Dyrus picks up 1. It's going to be even more coming as Bjergsen takes on Robert X Lee. Now Bubba Dub also to fall. 5-1 TSM, and they own this game.
That's what complete vision control at 24 minutes will do for you. With the Jarvan, Kassadin, and Gragas, TSM pick up kills on all sides of the screen there. Rewarded with the Baron afterwards. Such clean play from them.
Absolutely. Complexity have not been able to gum up the works at all. Nothing has gone in to stir TSM and require them to do anything. TSM choosing every fight.
So Frawley down there fighting off two members. The duo lane almost picks him up here. They will end up finishing off that kill, but the three members of TSM able to take out Complexity's bottom lane. And that, with them going down, a lot of the hope for Complexity does drop as well. Kez, I think that may have been one of the first Vi ultimates that I've seen from him this game.
You got Dyrus with one.
Oh yeah, he did get Dyrus with one for the exchange kill up top.
But that fight was just a gold lead.
And that fight cost them the dragon, the first dragon as well.
Yeah, true.
Or,
yeah.
The one we were referencing.
The one way back then when TSM started crushing everything.
When you're this far ahead, though, for TSM, you can literally just push all lanes at the same time. So right now they're split, pushing all three lanes and farming the jungle at the same time.
Mm-hmm. Send everyone to one place. One gets top jungle, one gets bottom jungle. One goes mid.
Dyrus by himself lanes. Down there. He does not actually have teleport, so he's not even looking to join the rest of the team. Just shoving down that bottom lane so it starts pushing and joining up with the rest.
So let's see how they close it out. We've had a lot of very long games. I believe day two was the longest average game length in LCS history, at least of the season. I forget the exact stat, but
yeah.
TSM is showing you don't have to play it 50 minutes. You can play it in 27. Mid-tier 2 under fire, probably could be in a whole bunch of danger, and he is. Goodbye. Tidal Wave saying, get out. So Complexity does.
This is just rough to watch here. TSM going to keep on rolling through. No Brawley. Oh, Dyrus with the flash.
Doesn't quite find much. In goes amazing as well, and now it's Kez in the back line, but he's got no one to help him. One kill picked up so far. Knockups there from Lulu, but the knockback for the Complexity, even more important. Four kills picked up. Robert actually the only one alive. And looks like he's going to get crit in the face. Nice kill, Wild Turtle. TSM 10-1 on the inhibitor turret.
They might not even leave this base here. The death timers are coming back up, but they've got Baron buff regeneration, and they've got Na'Vi. They can still sustain here.
All right, it's Prawley and no one else for 7 more seconds as turret number 1 is taking damage.
Well,
27
then.
And a half minutes. TSM want to close the week out in style. They go 3-1. They are guaranteed at least a tie for second. And if Dig loses the next game, TSM are in first place. Or I want to say the first time all split.
The most convincing win we've seen in Super Week.
TSM is the team with the most convincing wins. They took EG very convincingly. They took Complexity convincingly. They were 8-0, now 9-0 against the bottom three teams. These guys do not flinch when they know they can get the wins.
And again, it just goes back to that starting the game off on the right foot. Very, very strong lanes. and just waiting for that small advantage to grow and grow and grow. And wait till Complexity make the choice to send their jungler top. Boom, the lead explodes.
Yep. And that was a bit of a misplay by Complexity. They definitely did not need their top laner to die. That fight could have been a top lane turret and a kill for a dragon. That's actually better for Complexity, but small miscommunications, small misplays with these guys. Still keep in mind, COL came in with a rough schedule ahead of them, came out 2-2. That is pretty admirable, yeah. But the problem is that still puts them 2 games out of the playoff run. Like, they've got a few weeks left. We're past halfway point in the season. They want to make that playoff run. They've got to start picking up a couple more wins here.
They've done a good job, though. They've taken games off of a lot of the top teams. Complexity and Dignitas, or Cloud9 and Dignitas so far here. So they are making moves. When Complexity joined this league, they said that they knew they were going to have a rough time. They knew they were going to drop a lot of games. What they were looking to do was learn from those losses. That's the most important thing for them.
Yep.
So this one, there's not a lot to learn from it except for the lane matchups and the one small misplay up top.
Yeah, and the thing is, there's so many teams that used to like sort of build themselves on, all right, early game lead, get good lanes, close the game out. Mm-hmm. The old dominant Cloud9 was like that. Summer 2013 Cloud9 was, we're going to win all of our lanes, Midas can just sit in his jungle and counter gank, and then they'll crush. They went 3 losses that season, that split. That was phenomenal. They went to Worlds, number one seed in NA, and that was the style. TSM emulated that right here. It's a style that honestly works very well. It closes out games quickly. Like, it was very reminiscent of just like this old dominating team.
It doesn't always close out games quickly, Freak. We've seen so many teams during Super Week with early game-oriented teams getting these great leads, getting these giant leads, and then losing out to the teams with later games.
You've got
to
do it right.
With all these Kog'Maws. Yeah, exactly.
Sure. But yeah, you saw that with Dignitas versus Dig versus Complexity, right? It was earlier today. It was like, yeah, if you screw up and get caught by Shockwaves, okay, yeah, you can mess the game up. But
the top teams should be looking at TSM's games against the bottom teams.
Absolutely.
Because TSM are the team that actually finish out when they have these strong lanes.
Yeah, these are the guys that seem to have done the best at learning how to play the game right. And this was something that we had criticized them a little bit for in spring earlier this year, is they got thrown off really heavily at the end of the season by one of the patches, and they like lost so much of their ability to play the game properly. TSM, I think more than anyone, have embraced 4.10 the best. Amazing was criticized for, he can only play 4 champions in the jungle. They force him down to Jarvan. Does pretty well for himself this time, right? Picks good engages. I mean, okay, yeah, all your lanes are winning. It's easier to jungle them, but like,
that is
at the very least.
That's the situation for a jungler. It's like, that lane's winning, that lane's winning, that lane's
I'm
winning.
I'll knock down your turret.
Oh, you're up top? I'll take dragon. Sounds good.
Yeah, but I mean, at the very least, right, TSM definitely made good choices. They closed the game up very cleanly.
Yeah, they did.
They've had a couple of wins like that now, and maybe they can keep that one going. Well, we're going to take a break in the action. We've got a break in the action, so head over to Twitter and share your favorite moments from the day. Send them to @LOLEsports. Use the hashtag LCSBigPlays. TSM being very clean in that one. But to help us break down their win, let's send it over to Dash and Zyrian.
Thanks, Freak. Joining us at the analyst desk, we've got Dyrus from a victorious TSM. Nice win over Complexity there, as Freak was saying, very clean. That moves you to 3-1 on the weekend, and also puts you into a 3-way tie for second, just a half a game behind Dignitas, which ultimately could turn into a 4-way tie for first, depending on the outcome of today's final game. How does that feel to be back up in the pack and in contention for the top spot?
It's great. I wasn't even paying attention to it all this time. All I care about is us getting better as a team, and we're prepared to lose as much as possible. Of course, we lose as much as possible to the top teams, and then they lose to Complexity and EG, so we get scared, and it's like, oh wow, you know, we still got it. It's just we got a little bit of tinkering to do.
Yeah, you're extremely consistent because you're 9-0 versus the bottom teams, whereas every other top team just seems to struggle with them. Like, why do you think that is?
That just sounds like sad. You're 9-0 against the bottom teams. Congratulations.
I know, right?
You're the king of the losers. No offense. They're really good. Like, they can beat Dignitas C9. Like, what do we know, you know? We have to learn the secrets from them. Maybe we just got to go back to our NA roots of NA meta. Good old Complexity NA meta solo queue. But anyways, like, it's great because it gives us more breathing room and we don't get relegated. That's always nice. We get to keep our jobs as long as we're doing our job and, you know, just getting better.
Yeah, and out of those top teams, besides TSM, which two do you think are in that top 3 if the pack does break away?
in terms of like teams in general, like the best top three?
Yeah, out of the top.
Well,
we'll include TSM.
Okay. right now we're there, but we're kind of not, you know.
Okay, like, we'll remove kinda, TSM.
Well, all right. So right now it goes by Dignitas because they have best Baron shot calls in the game right now. Which, ironically, yeah.
Yeah, right.
And then LMQ, they aren't afraid. They're never afraid, and that's something they have the confidence. They don't have lack of confidence. They come into the games and they're never afraid. And lack of confidence will, you know, hold you back, like internationally and even on NA stage. For example, I guess I'll use our Curse game. I feel like when they played against us, they could have easily beaten us, but I felt there was a slight lack of confidence in some parts of their play. So they barely lost to us. But then, you know, after they had their ordeal, I guess they just, you know, sweeped everyone else. And that was their hard team, CLG, two other teams. And I'm sorry, I have bad memory. Just like LMQ, there's confidence there, and it's really strong. As for the third team, I need time to think about it, but I guess I'll just put TSM there for now.
Yeah. All right, I like that. Now, moving into specifically this game, I want to talk about the Gragas pick that you pulled out, mostly because now at this point in the split, Gragas is 2-7. That's with that win that you just picked up. So prior to that, 1-6, and you had played him once before, to no avail. So why were you comfortable going back onto that champion and looking for a win with him?
Just picking a solid top that can, you know, support my team. Usually I'd be picking like Jax and trying to like carry the game on my own, and we wouldn't know how to play towards that style. I picked Gragas because he's just a strong, solid top laner, and regardless of records for any champion in the game, in the end, it all depends on the player. Like, you could put Koreans on literally the low-tier champions, and they'd have a high win rate because they play it well, you know? Mm-hmm. It's not always about the champions and draft, but also the players themselves.
Yeah, it might also have something to do with figuring out the right build and things along those lines and how to play it. Because when Lucian first came out, all the Koreans were playing it, and they were losing with him over and over again. And now he's picked pretty much every game, and last patch, every game again. So I think Gragas might be in that same vein.
Yeah, and that kind of aspect, like what you just said, that's a perfect example. Not knowing the item builds, people kind of figuring out. And Gragas is the kind of champion that it's kind of more on the player because there's three skill shots and one kind of like auto attack cancel, but it's, like I said, it's mostly on the player, skill shots.
So there's an interesting, you staying on that same vein of the item builds, an interesting thing you did with Gragas here in this game was that you built him slightly more tanky than you did last time. You picked up the Zhonyas instead of Arabidons, but not quite as tanky as some people, going with the Frozen Fist and the Randuin's right out the gate. So do you think that that's the kind of middle ground that Gragas should sit in?
It's a work in progress. I think it's a preference, and every player should go their own build. Any build can work, full tank, full AP, you know, in the middle. Like, it's how you feel that, you know, fits towards your team and you as a player, of what you like best.
All right, and you've been talking about TSM. You guys are middle of the pack for a while. Now you guys have just started getting up there, and like he said, three-way tie for second right now, possibly four-way tie for first. How much of that is Locodoco? Come on.
Wins and losses are part of Locodoco. He's basically our sixth man on the team, along with some others. I don't know if it's been announced yet. But Locodoco, like, I don't really treat him as, like, you know, that extra person, but he's part of our team. When we lose, we all lose together. When we win together. And he's a big part of it.
And what has he done for your play style since he's come on board?
In TSM in general, or just me?
You, personally.
So he knows a lot of things in the Korean scene, and he brings the knowledge of, let's say, runes and masteries to me. And how the best top laners in Korea do certain things, that kind of gets relayed over to me. And I'm the kind of player, since for the last 3 or 4 years, I'm not really the innovator, but the only reason why I've been good and I've kept up and I haven't been benched yet is because I'm able to adapt and copy other people. I'm a big copycat.
I like it. It's very honest, to say the least. Now, I want to jump back into the game more specifically. We're going to pull a replay up here. It's about 24 minutes in. It's in the Complexity Red Jungle, where you guys get a nice 3-0 and then follow it up with the Baron. Just kind of explain to me how you happened upon this situation and then why the calls were made to go for Baron.
So we thought they were going to go for their blue, but they didn't. So my team decided to go for Baron anyways. I wasn't paying attention. They told me to TP, but I wanted blue buff, so I need the extra auto. I just TP'd to the closest thing I saw, didn't look at it before. It ulted as soon as I could. Bjergsen messed up and used his Zhonya's in lane before this fight, so he almost died. And I just cleaning up. Like, I didn't really do much there. My team won their 4-on-4, and I won my 1-on-1.
And I think you guys also won champion select pretty far out there. They banned 3 junglers, and then they didn't pick a jungler first rotation. Like, what were you guys thinking? You're like, just Jarvan, and that's it?
So I guess what teams have noticed against us is that we lose on Jarvan, but it honestly isn't him. Like, it isn't amazing. It's just the whole team in general, and it's kind of inconsistent how we win and lose against certain teams. So when they look at the stats, they're like, oh, they do this or this, and then we come into the game, it's like, that's not what they did last time, you know? But then again, you know, I wouldn't really give any teams Cassidy, and I'm not sure about that.
All right, yeah, that's fair. Now, final question before we move on is the fact that you guys are now sitting here in second place, possibly first. Now, with this 3-1 momentum coming out of Super Week, how are you going to push forward and make sure that you kind of do break away from the pack and move into that top slot?
First of all, we need to catch up with the meta right now. Right now, we're kind of stuck at our early mid-game style, and we're going to move on and, you know, just expand our horizons, you know.
So poetic. Anyway, Dyrus, thank you so much for joining us at the desk, and congratulations on a great Super Week. We've got to take a quick break, but when we come back, we'll cap off our Super Week with Dignitas taking on Cloud9. Don't hit refresh. You won't want to miss a minute of the action.
Focus. Crawley gets a shield, just gets away, but there's the ignite, there's the wild growth, but it's not enough. Dyrus picks up one. It's going to be even more coming as Bjergsen takes on Robert X Lee. Now Bubba up also to fall. One kill picked up so far. Knockups there from Lulu, but the knockbacks, the complexity, even more important.